1864, Lincoln at the Gates of History, by Charles Bracelen Flood. Narrated by Mel Foster. Copyright 2009 by Charles Bracelen Flood. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Charles Bracelen Flood and Neerham & Williams at Fish & Richardson, P.C., and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media, Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Chapter 1. The Beleaguered Giant. On the morning of January 1, 1864, 8,000 people waited in line on the frozen, sunlit lawns of the White House, eager to greet President Abraham Lincoln at the traditional New Year's Day reception. At noon, they poured into the mansion. Ushers pointed the way to the East Room, brightly lit by massive gas-burning crystal chandeliers. The Marine Band, splendid in scarlet tunics, played lively tunes. Official Washington had already passed through the receiving line. Ambassadors and their wives, the justices of the Supreme Court, members of the Cabinet, senators and congressmen with their families. Following them came officers of the Union Army and the United States Navy, veterans of the 33 months of fighting that had taken place thus far in the Civil War. Abraham Lincoln towered above the crowd pressing around him, his raw-boned body just under 6'4" and weighing 180 pounds, clad in an ill-fitting black suit. A man of great strength and stooped posture, he moved awkwardly and had a rumpled, untidy appearance. Despite his efforts to comb and brush what he called his coarse black hair, he said it always looked like a bird's nest. On formal occasions like this, he slipped his large hands into white kid gloves, giving them the appearance, Lincoln thought, of canvased hams. Beside him stood his wife, Mary Todd Lincoln, 5'2" and plump, who came down from the family quarters late in the morning, 90 minutes after Lincoln began to shake hands with their guests. She wore what a newspaper account described as a purple velvet dress decorated with white satin flutings that had an immense train. A headdress with a large white plume topped off her costume. In this era, when most fashionable ladies wore hoop skirts, a heavy-set short woman looked as if her top half had emerged from a dome. Aides kept trying to push the well-wishers past the president as soon as they shook his hand. One of the young men who served as his private secretary calculated that Lincoln could shake hands and say a word of greeting once every 4 or 5 seconds, but many of those who came to see the president stood rooted to the spot, as if they gained strength by staying near him. Lincoln kept shaking hands, occasionally using his left hand while he rested his right, nodding encouragingly as he exchanged brief pleasantries. Sometimes his craggy, bearded face would break into a smile. Answering a remark in his high-pitched voice, the man who had delivered the Gettysburg Address 6 weeks before occasionally slipped into the rustic terms, "I reckon," or "By jings." At other moments he might greet a friend with a hearty, "Howdy." Lincoln pronounced chair as cheer, "Mr. Cheerman," and when he laughed, it reminded one listener of the neighing of a wild horse. At times his mind seemed elsewhere. During public receptions he tried to greet everyone in a cheerful and confident manner, but few imagined not only the mental numbness, but also the physical exertion and discomfort involved in shaking thousands of hands. As the crowd kept coming through, people jammed together so closely that one of them said the crushing of bonnets and things was fearful. Some citizens acquired souvenirs by plucking buttons from embroidered furniture, and others surreptitiously used scissors to cut little squares from curtains. After these long sessions, when Lincoln took off his white gloves, his secretaries could see that his right hand was swollen, bruised, and sometimes bloody. Occasionally, Lincoln saw something at these receptions that moved him to action. A friend observed this. The president had been standing for some time, bowing his acknowledgments to the thronging multitude, when his eye fell upon a couple who had entered unobserved, a wounded soldier and his plainly dressed mother. He made his way to where they stood, and taking each of them by the hand with a delicacy and cordiality that brought tears to many eyes, he assured them of his interest and welcome. Governors, senators, diplomats, passed with merely a nod, but that pale young face he might never see again. To him and to others like him did the nation owe its life. Before this reception on the first day of 1864 finished, something unique occurred. For the first time since 1785, when George Washington began the custom of having these New Year's gatherings, when New York City was the nation's capital, blacks arrived as guests to be presented to the president. A California newspaper described them as being four colored men of genteel exterior and with the manners of gentlemen. Lincoln shook hands with each man, using his last name and calling him Mr. The moment had its significance, but it was equally significant that only four black men, evidently without their wives, were at an occasion attended by 8,000 people. 2. The reception ended at mid-afternoon of this bitterly cold day. Lincoln escaped the White House and walked to the three-story brick building on the wooded White House grounds at the corner of 17th Street and Pennsylvania Avenue that housed a large part of the War Department. He walked in an odd way, moving the long legs of his lanky body in a full stride, covering the ground quickly. But he put the soles of his feet down so flat with each step that he seemed to be stamping along. Crossing the icy grass, a tall black top hat on his head and a gray plaid shawl flung across his shoulders, he was making one of his innumerable visits to the headquarters of the Union Army. A soldier there said that Lincoln would come over morning, afternoon, and evening to receive the latest news from the armies at the front. He seldom failed to come over late in the evening before retiring, and sometimes he would stay all night. The White House was not connected to the telegraph system. All of the presidential telegrams came in or went out of the building to which he was now headed. Lincoln did not have to go in person. Military messengers could have carried telegrams back and forth swiftly, but he preferred doing this. At the headquarters door, the blue-uniformed sentry raised his musket to present arms, and Lincoln returned the salute with a bow and a touch of his hat. He climbed the stairs to the second floor and hung his shawl over the top of a high screen door that separated Secretary of War Edwin M. Stanton's office from the office that handled the most important telegrams, those in code. Moving along one side of the room where young soldiers tapped out and received encoded messages at their marble-topped desks, Lincoln came to a chest against a wall. He opened the top drawer, into which these cipher clerks placed the messages they had decoded in order of receipt, each one in the form of a yellow tissue paper telegraphic dispatch. As one of the young operators described it, each time Lincoln entered, he would read over the telegrams, beginning at the top, until he came to the one he had seen at his last previous visit. Today, one of the most important of these indicated that Confederate Major General Jubal Early might have moved more than 6,000 men of his swift-striking forces into an area of Virginia and West Virginia only 60 miles northwest of Washington, and could begin attacks there within 24 hours. Here was the war, staring Lincoln in the face. After 3 years of fighting, his massive army could not capture the Confederate capital of Richmond, 95 miles to the south, while Jubal Early, one of the Confederacy's better generals, could still threaten places northwest of Washington, such as Harper's Ferry, West Virginia, or Sharpsburg, Maryland, scene of the Battle of Antietam, fought 15 months before. Lincoln, whose constant involvement in military matters came from his mistrust of the Union Army's leadership, wrote a message to the officer in charge at Harper's Ferry, Brigadier General Jeremiah Sullivan, a pre-war naval officer and civilian lawyer who earlier in the war served creditably in staff positions in the Western Theater. Sullivan was no match for Early, a West Point veteran of the Mexican War, who, since 1861, had gained much combat experience commanding large bodies of troops. Sent at 3:30 in the afternoon, Lincoln's message read, "Have you anything new from Winchester, Martinsburg, or thereabouts? A. Lincoln." Once he dealt with his incoming telegrams, Lincoln would go over and sit at a wooden desk by the window. Starting early in the war, he found it a haven, an office without walls. No one bothered him there. The young operators kept working at their desks a few yards from him, and as one of them assessed the situation, he would there relax from the strain and care ever present in the White House. Lincoln did more than that. He often worked there as he waited, sometimes for hours, for the answer to a message, such as the one he had just sent. During a big battle, he would walk into Stanton's office and spend hour after hour with his war secretary, where he could read the telegrams as fast as they were received and handed in from the adjoining room. In June and July of 1862, he sat at that desk beside the window in the telegraph office as he developed his ideas of how to begin to end slavery without losing the support of Maryland, Delaware, Kentucky, and Missouri, the border states in which slavery was still entrenched. There, he penned the first draft of his Emancipation Proclamation, issued in September of 1862, to take effect on January 1, 1863, the New Year's Day before this. Lincoln had signed the official document just after the New Year's White House reception, identical to the one from which he had just come. At today's reception, those eagerly crowding around him as the Marine Band played had seen what they wished to see, their president, their leader, the man with a strong, homely face to whom they looked for victory and the end of the national convulsion. If they saw him now, staring out the window into the cold, darkening afternoon, a different image would confront them. The 54-year-old president looked haggard, with what one man called great black rings under his eyes. 33 months of war had turned his leathery dark skin gray, and strands of gray ran through Lincoln's shaggy black hair. Another man who studied him closely observed, "Lines of care plowed his face." The expression was remarkably pensive and tender, often sad, as if a reservoir of tears lay very near the surface. Since giving the Gettysburg Address in November, he had been ill of a fever, worse on some days and better on others. After it left him, it would later be thought he had contracted some form of smallpox. As he sat at that window, waiting for an answer from General Sullivan at Harper's Ferry, Lincoln faced yet another year of crushing challenges. No American president had ever come under such pressure. When he left his home in Springfield, Illinois, for the White House 3 years before, he gave a brief speech from the steps of the train about to carry him away. Lincoln told the crowd of friends who came to see him off, "I now leave with a task before me greater than that which rested upon Washington." To work at that task, the nation had elected a leader who, in the editorial opinion of Connecticut's Republican-affiliated Hartford Courant, possessed the intellectual power of a giant with the simple habits of a backwoods farmer. The ever-present Democratic opposition saw him as a terrible choice. In his own town, the Springfield Register called his election a national calamity, while the Atlas and Argus of Albany, New York, described him as a slang-wanging stump speaker, of which all parties are ashamed. The influential New York Herald characterized him as a fourth-rate lecturer who cannot speak good grammar, a man whose speeches consisted of the most unmitigated trash interlarded with coarse and clumsy jokes. The war that started 5 weeks after Lincoln's inauguration on March 4, 1861, grew enormously. As 1864 began, close to 1 million Union troops confronted 700,000 Confederates, fighting in actions that ranged from major battles to guerrilla skirmishes in places as far from each other as the Virginia coast, Missouri, and Texas, a winding and often shifting front of some 2,000 miles. To Lincoln's acute disappointment and frustration, as well as that of the Northern public, after 3 years of bloody campaigns, some of them bungled, the military struggle continued to hang in the balance. During 1863, Federal troops won at Gettysburg, Vicksburg, and Chattanooga, but the Confederate States Army still possessed the strength, the will, and much of the leadership that struck so hard at Chancellorsville and Chickamauga. In addition to their skill and valor, during 1861 and 1862, the Confederates had captured immense amounts of Union Army equipment and supplies, much of it still in use. Robert E. Lee's office at his field headquarters was in a horse-drawn ambulance on whose canvas sides appeared the faded letters U.S., showing that it had belonged to Federal forces. Union casualties shocked the North. Twice as many soldiers died from disease as from enemy fire. From all causes, the Union had lost a total of 210,000 of its soldiers and sailors, and no one could predict how many scores of thousands might be sacrificed in the coming year. Wounded and dying men filled Washington. They lay not only in the 21 military hospitals created since the war began, but received care in converted warehouses, hotels, schools, and even private houses whose owners tended them. At one time, wounded also lay in cots within the Capitol building. In addition, more than 100,000 men had deserted. In late 1863, a patriotic youth who enlisted in the army at Albany found himself herded in among 800 or 1,000 ruffians, closely guarded by heavy lines of sentinels. These men, being sent to the front against their will, were bounty jumpers, who accepted a bonus for enlisting and either failed to appear for service or deserted from the ranks at the first opportunity. This recruit found that some had jumped the bounty in, say, half a dozen cities. There was not a man of them who was not eager to run away, not a man who did not quake when he thought of the front. During this contingent's shipment south to the fighting in Virginia, at different times guards shot 8 men dead as they attempted to desert. One of those killed tried to escape by leaping off a steamer into the winter waters of the Hudson River. Sitting there in the telegraph office, waiting to learn if Jubal Early might start the new year by threatening Washington, Lincoln knew just how resolute an enemy he faced. Confederate President Jefferson Davis and the White South remained defiant and determined. In Davis's recent annual message to the Confederate Congress, he said, "At the commencement of this war, we were far from anticipating the magnitude and duration of the struggle in which we were engaged," the mirror image of the North's experience, but closed with, "We have been united as a people were never united under like circumstances before." A succession of generals Lincoln chose to oppose Robert E. Lee in Virginia had failed him. The Confederate forces had themselves experienced significant numbers of desertions, but virtually all the regiments of Lee's formidable Army of Northern Virginia were about to re-enlist to fight on as long as the war should last. The passionately felt need to win the war, to stop the slaughter, agonized Lincoln as commander-in-chief. That distress extended into the civilian world. As this election year of 1864 began, the military situation dominated the North's increasingly painful political realities. The North was sick of this endless battle to determine whether the United States would be one nation or two. When the supply of Union volunteers ran out in 1863 and the federal government introduced conscription, riots in New York City protesting the draft claimed more than 100 lives and showed the weakening support for the war. The presidential election that lay ahead in November would, in effect, be a referendum on an unpopular war and on the war-weary Northern public's view of secession and slavery. One great question presented itself, whether to fight on after 3 harrowing years, losing more sons, brothers, husbands, and fathers, or cede to the South the issue for which the blood flowed, to let the Confederate States of America go its way, an independent nation practicing slavery. Even if Lincoln could win the Republican Party's nomination to run for re-election, other prominent and popular Republicans wanted that nomination themselves, he faced a daunting task. No political consensus existed within his own Republican Party. The majority of Republicans, sometimes called conservatives, supported Lincoln's moderate conciliatory positions toward the states that had seceded. The fewer but far more vocal radicals resolutely opposed Lincoln's more conciliatory plans. Although not a separate party, this powerful Republican faction had such a distinct identity that people referring to it frequently used a capital R. Lincoln believed that the Constitution did not permit a state to secede, and that the states now calling themselves the Confederate States of America were best dealt with by considering them as being out of their proper practical relations with the rest of the nation. He avoided referring to Jefferson Davis as President Davis because that implied the existence of a validly constituted nation that Davis had the right to lead, and he used the term rebels rather than Confederates. His moderate approach included the idea of starting the political reconstruction of any hostile Southern state as soon as the tide of war brought significant territory back into Union hands. Thus, even if in wartime 10% of a rebel state's pre-war voters could be found who would swear an oath of loyalty to the Union and a willingness to obey presidential proclamations and federal laws regarding slavery, that state could begin the process of resuming its proper practical relations with the states that had not seceded. Based on that nucleus of 10%, if that state wrote a new constitution that included the abolition of slavery, it could be reabsorbed into the Union. Lincoln saw this plan as a way to undermine the Confederacy and fight a political war within the military one. The radicals, on the other hand, saw Lincoln's policies as being too slow in abolishing slavery and too lenient to those they regarded as being guilty of treason. They wanted immediate and complete equality for all slaves as soon as the land on which they lived came under the control of the Union Army. If the Union went on to win the war, they wanted severe restrictions on readmitting Southern state governments and Confederate soldiers to the nation's political process. A Confederate officer was not to be allowed to vote and hold office as if he had not taken up arms and led soldiers against the United States of America. The radicals saw a post-war era in terms of states such as proud Virginia and incendiary South Carolina being on a strict and lengthy probation. That was the scene in the Republican camp, but Lincoln's main opponents displayed even greater disarray. The Peace Democrats, a significant faction sometimes referred to as copperheads by characterizing them as poisonous snakes biting the Union in the back, eagerly explored every avenue that might lead to immediate peace negotiations and compromise. The larger body of Democrats, the War Democrats, were willing to fight on, but their priorities placed the restoration of the Union far above the question of the present and future status of the 4 million slaves in the South. The political turmoil might easily produce a third party. Confusion and inconsistency abounded. Indiana lived in political and fiscal limbo. When the state legislature's Democratic majority attempted to strip Republican Governor Oliver P. Morton of his military powers, the minority Republicans walked out, leaving the assembly unable to form a quorum. After the legislature adjourned, deliberately leaving Morton without the power to enact taxes to finance the state's share of the war effort, the governor started to rule by executive order. Because Morton could not collect the revenue needed to run the state, Secretary of War Stanton sent him shipments of cash from Washington, and Morton also borrowed money from bankers and the county governments remaining loyal to the Union. Facing all this, an increasingly unpopular war and a powerful growing opposition, Lincoln intended to run for re-election. Exhausted and discouraged though he often was, his ability and ambition had brought him from being a penniless, self-educated boy to the presidency. From youth to manhood, he knew the uncertain, harsh life of the Illinois prairie frontier, with its ice-locked winters and parched summers. In that unforgiving world, Lincoln survived, prevailed, went on to bigger towns and increasingly higher positions. Reporter Horace White of the Chicago Press and Tribune, who covered Lincoln during his debates with Senator Stephen A. Douglas in the 1858 Illinois senatorial contest that brought him to national attention, had 6 years before rendered this judgment: "There's no back down in old Abe." During his 25 years practicing law in Illinois, Lincoln won the reputation of making the best closing arguments of any lawyer in the state. Determined to be strong to the end in whatever he undertook, he wanted to see the nation through its greatest crisis. Lincoln possessed a sense of the vastness of America, the possibilities of its people, and the challenges of its evolving society and economy. In August of 1856, 55 months before the war began to tear the country apart, the idea of a special American destiny and opportunity already firmly occupied his mind. He said this at a gathering of 10,000 Republicans at Kalamazoo, Michigan. "We are a great empire. We are 80 years old. We stand at once the wonder and admiration of the whole world. And we must inquire what it is that has given us so much prosperity. This cause is that every man can make himself." On this first day of 1864, Lincoln, the archetypal self-made man, now had a year in which to win the election and keep up the pressure to defeat the Confederacy. He had to win in political caucuses and on the battlefields, lead the Union on to victory, and finally exorcise slavery, the Republic's original sin. 3. 2 hours after he sent off his request for intelligence concerning Jubal Early's movements, Lincoln received General Sullivan's reply. "I have ordered a force to Winchester strong enough to develop anything that may be there. I believe the reports received from Martinsburg this morning were premature. I am now leaving for Martinsburg myself." The telegram reduced Lincoln's fear that the unpredictable Robert E. Lee was launching a surprise New Year's offensive, an eruption from the Shenandoah Valley like the one the summer before, in which Lee and his men advanced north into Pennsylvania before being decisively beaten at Gettysburg. Because that valley became wider as it ran north, movements within it were referred to in counterintuitive terms. Lee marched north down the valley. Later, Lincoln walked back to the White House in the dusk to have his usual simple supper with his wife and their 10-year-old son, Tad. For Lincoln, the 31-room mansion had become a place of shadows. In 1862, the second year he and Mary occupied the White House, their son Willie died of typhoid fever at the age of 11. It was their second loss. In 1849, 7 years after they married, their 3-year-old son Eddie had died of tuberculosis at their home in Springfield. Though they had 2 surviving sons, Robert, 19, in 1862 and a student at Harvard, and Tad, who was then not quite 9 and continued to live with them at the White House, Willie had been the child on whom they particularly doted, a sensitive and graceful boy who loved riding his little pony on the White House lawns. Lincoln saw much of himself in Willie. On one occasion, he said to a guest at breakfast, "I know every step of the process by which Willie solved problems. As it is by just such slow methods, I attain results." When Willie died, going from perfect health to death in 2 weeks, Mary was, as her seamstress confidant and freed slave Elizabeth Keckley wrote, "completely overwhelmed by the tragedy." Elizabeth also recalled the moment when Lincoln first came into the second-floor White House bedroom in which his son had died, and saw him lying there. He buried his face in his hands, and his tall frame was convulsed with emotion. His grief unnerved him and made him a weak, passive child. I did not dream that his rugged nature could be so moved. I shall never forget those moments. Genius and greatness weeping over love's idol lost. There's a grandeur as well as a simplicity about the picture that will never fade. With me, it is immortal. I really believe that I shall carry it with me across the dark, mysterious river of death. 4. Lincoln suppers with Mary and Tad, sometimes a close friend or two joined them, were a bittersweet mixture of friendly conversation, wartime tension, and unhappy memories. Tad was a lively, mischievous boy. During one White House reception, he startled the presidential guests by driving through the gathering on a makeshift sled pulled by one of his pet goats. After Willie's death, the Lincolns continued to spoil Tad as outrageously as they had always spoiled both those boys. But Mary was an unstable and demanding woman who had experienced grief and stress apart from the loss of her favorite child. The well-educated daughter of a prominent slaveholding family in Lexington, Kentucky, she and Lincoln came from different warring cultures. Mary had a brother, three half-brothers, and three brothers-in-law in the Confederate Army. Her three half-brothers had died fighting for the Confederacy. Confederate General Ben Hardin Helm, the husband of her favorite half-sister Emily, had died from wounds received at Chickamauga just 13 weeks before this New Year's Day. General Helm's death gave rise to an extraordinary situation. Lincoln, fond of Emily himself, stepped in to help Mary's newly widowed half-sister and her 7-year-old daughter Catherine get back safely from Alabama, deep in the Confederacy, to her mother's house in Union-held Lexington, Kentucky. This involved her first entering Union territory by ship, landing at the federal coastal bastion of Fort Monroe, Virginia. It appears that the Union officers there required her to take an oath of allegiance to the United States before allowing her to proceed to Washington. Emily, an ardent Confederate sympathizer and the widow of a Confederate officer, evidently refused to do this. There are conflicting versions of what happened next. An undocumented story in Emily's family had it that Lincoln broke the impasse by sending the authorities at Fort Monroe a 4-word telegram, "Send her to me." In any event, Emily did not sign the oath, and she and her little girl arrived in Washington about December 8 to stay for a time with Mary in the White House. Emily recalled, "Mr. Lincoln and my sister met me with the warmest affection. We were all too grief-stricken at first for speech. We could only embrace each other in silence and tears." The young widow also wrote in her diary, "She and Brother Lincoln pet me as if I were a child, and without words try to comfort me." News of a Confederate general's widow being a guest in the White House caused so much criticism, particularly of Mary Lincoln, that Emily decided to cut short her visit. Aware of the adverse public reaction, Lincoln nevertheless urged Emily to stay, saying that Mary's nerves had gone to pieces and Emily's presence comforted her. Emily agreed about Mary's mental condition, telling Lincoln, "She seems very nervous, and once or twice when I have come into the room suddenly, the look in her eyes has appalled me." Still, after less than a week at the White House, Emily departed for Kentucky with her daughter on December 14, 1863. In the hours before she left, Lincoln gave Emily a pass, signed by him, that would get her through any Union checkpoints. He also handed her an oath of allegiance written in his own hand. Then Lincoln rode out and gave her a letter granting her amnesty. Part of it read, "In regard to said restored rights of person and property, she is to be protected and afforded facilities as a loyal person." Perhaps because he knew that Emily would never sign the oath herself, Lincoln went ahead and signed her name on that document. Despite her family ties to the South, Mary firmly supported the Union cause and had always believed that an important destiny awaited her husband. She had thrown in her lot with him 22 years before in Illinois, when he was, as her niece Catherine Helm later wrote, a struggling young lawyer, the plainest-looking man in Springfield. She, like he, experienced episodes of depression. Lincoln, who sometimes called his states of depression hypo for hypochondria, a Victorian synonym for melancholy, once said, "I laugh because I must not weep, that's all," and also commented that a good funny story has the same effect on me that I suppose a good square drink of whiskey has on a toper. It puts new life in me. Mary suffered from migraine headaches, as Lincoln occasionally did, and aspects of her behavior presented him with problems from the beginnings of their marriage. This same niece recalled that back in Springfield, while Mary was courageous and daring about most things, a thunderstorm was terrifying to her. Mr. Lincoln, knowing this, at the first muttering of thunder, would leave his law office and hurry home to quiet her fears until the storm was over. Now, with long casualty lists appearing daily, Mary constantly feared that their oldest son Robert, a senior at Harvard, would enter the Union Army as he wished to do, and be the third of her four sons to die. Just weeks before this New Year's, she found herself in a sudden, unexpected exchange on this subject that demonstrated the emotions that lay beneath Washington's polite talk. During a small White House gathering, Republican Senator Ira Harris of New York, a man Mary considered to be a friend, abruptly asked her, "Why isn't Robert in the Army? He's old enough and strong enough to serve his country. He should have gone to the front some time ago." Mary's half-sister Emily Helm was present during her brief visit. She said that Mary's face turned white, and she offered some explanation, but Harris rose to go, saying pointedly, "I have only one son, and he is fighting for his country." Another powerful set of fears haunted Mary concerning her husband's safety. On their way east from Springfield in early 1861 for Lincoln's inauguration, a plot to assassinate Lincoln as he emerged from one railroad station in Baltimore to go to another was thwarted by putting him on an earlier train and spiriting him across that Confederate sympathizing city at 3 a.m. Traveling with her son Robert aboard the train on which Lincoln would have been, Mary was in one of its cars in Baltimore when a mob stormed onto their train looking for him. Those fears never ceased. The White House could be entered by almost anybody, and on one occasion, a man named Francis Xavier, who proved to be harmless, got in to see Lincoln and announced that he had been elected president in 1856 and that Lincoln should leave immediately so he could begin to govern. Mary received a serious injury during an accident intended to harm her husband. On July 2, 1863, when she was the only passenger in a carriage that she and Lincoln usually shared whenever she could get him to take one of the late afternoon rides they both enjoyed, the driver's seat fell off, and the driver fell to the ground. As the horses bolted, Mary was thrown out, cutting her head on a rock. Infection set in, and she remained in bed for 3 weeks. Mary had more of her severe headaches from this time on, and her son Robert felt that she never completely recovered from her injuries. An inspection of the carriage revealed that the fastenings under the driver's seat had been unscrewed, ensuring that an accident would occur. 5. After supper, Lincoln usually went back to work. Family quarters occupied much of the second floor of the White House, but near one end was what those with whom he worked called the President's Business Office, and Lincoln called the shop. A journalist who saw this large room during the day described it as having 2 large draperied windows looking out upon the broad Potomac and commanding the Virginia Heights opposite, on which the tents of numberless military camps are whitening in the sun. Down its center ran a long black walnut table used for the customary Tuesday afternoon meeting of Lincoln's cabinet. A visitor noted that plain straw matting covered the floor. Two armchairs and a sofa upholstered in green worsted sat along one wall, under large maps of the different theaters of war. Against the opposite wall stood an old mahogany upright desk with pigeonholes for filing papers. Between the two windows was a desk at which Lincoln wrote letters, read documents sent him for endorsement, and signed state papers. When he came up to this room after supper to continue his labors, he might find senators and congressmen arriving uninvited to confer with him. But at other times, as his private secretary John Hay wrote, he shut himself up and would see no one. Whether Lincoln worked alone or with others, intense activity always took place in his office during daylight hours. He rose at dawn or earlier, frequently after a night with little or no sleep, and often began the day working by himself at his desk between the large draperied windows. Then he would go downstairs for a breakfast that consisted of a cup of coffee and an egg. His lunch was similarly meager. Hay described it as a biscuit, a glass of milk in winter, some fruits or grapes in summer. By 7 he was back at work, aided by two of his dedicated private secretaries, Hay and John Nicolay, who, among other duties, kept him connected with the government's administrative departments and his political constituencies. Added to the official correspondence, letters poured in from citizens all over the Union. 28-year-old William O. Stoddard was the secretary who sorted out this unofficial mail and decided which letters from the public should be discarded and which should be answered. He said of his job, "I doubt if there was any spot in the United States in those days, outside of a battlefield, that was more continually interesting than the correspondence desk of the Executive Mansion." Stoddard, who also served as Mary Lincoln's unofficial social secretary, had been a venturesome youth. A native of Syracuse, New York, he left the University of Rochester in his senior year and headed west for Chicago, where he was an itinerant book peddler and tried his hand at writing for that city's Daily Ledger before buying a farm in eastern Illinois. Disliking the realities of farming, he began to work for the Central Illinois Gazette and became involved in the editing and ownership of a small newspaper that backed Lincoln in his home state. When Lincoln became a candidate for president in 1860, Stoddard said that he went into the political canvass head over heels and ran the Republican campaign in Champaign County on my own hands. Brought into the White House not long after Lincoln was inaugurated, Stoddard had carved out for himself this daily task of sorting through Lincoln's voluminous non-governmental mail and deciding what should be brought to the president's attention. In addition to this, from 1861 to 1864, he submitted more than 120 weekly columns to the New York Examiner. Writing under the pseudonym Illinois, he provided a combination of inside Washington gossip and admiring sympathetic descriptions of Lincoln's activities. Stoddard's selection of the letters that Lincoln should see gave the president a bond with citizens who in some cases lived thousands of miles from the White House. On this first day of 1864, a man named Otho Hinton of Santa Rosa, California, wrote Lincoln a letter that began, "I avail myself of the privilege exercised by the humblest citizen from the earliest ages of civil government among men to address the executive upon great and important measures of state policy, and especially in times like these." This reflected a deep feeling among many citizens during the Civil War, something that one of the lesser secretaries described in these words, "Every patriot became intensely interested in the strife, and felt that they must sit down and give their thoughts to the official head of the Republic." Even at a distance of 1,000 miles, Abraham Lincoln seemed approachable, a man of the people who would listen to you. And send him their thoughts they did. Stoddard reported of the incoming bundles of mail. Some days there will be less than 200 separate lots, large and small. Some days there will be over 300. He opened every letter, but added, "Are they all red?" "Not exactly. With a big wicker wastebasket on either side of this chair, a good half of each mail belongs in them, as fast as you can find it out. The other half calls for more or less respectful treatment." That might mean forwarding a letter to the appropriate government bureau for a response, or Lincoln telling either John Nicolay or John Hay what reply should be written for him to sign, or Lincoln putting aside a letter that he wished to answer himself. Stoddard characterized some of those letters from the public that he threw out as being stories of partisan bitterness and personal hatred, of the most venomous malice, seeking to shoot with poisoned arrows of abuse, of low, slanderous meannesses, of the coarsest, foulest vulgarity to which beastly men can sink, of the wildest, the fiercest, and the most obscene ravings of utter insanity. In terms of meeting the public face to face, Lincoln tried to receive virtually anyone who wished to see him, and did this from 10 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon. Wives and mothers of convicted deserters from the Union Army entered this room to plead with him, usually with success, to commute sentences of execution. Men came asking for government jobs and promotions. Others who did not need his help hard-heartedly referred to these sessions as beggars' operas. He listened to all requests, complaints, and comments, feeling that he owed that to the citizens he served. But he also found this useful. From many of these conversations, he learned how people viewed him and his administration, and referred to these daily sessions as his public opinion baths. Lincoln usually treated his visitors patiently, but sometimes the constant strain under which he lived overcame him. And on one occasion, this man of great mental power demonstrated the physical strength still possessed by the Illinois frontier woodsman, who in his youth often swung an axe for hours as he felled trees. One of Lincoln's secretaries described the incident, unique in recorded presidential behavior. A man who had called on Lincoln almost every day for weeks was shown in, and proceeded to ask again for a government position that the president had repeatedly told him he was not going to be given. When Lincoln once more told him politely that the post he sought was not to be his, the man said, in what this eyewitness called a very insolent tone, that the president was treating him unjustly. Lincoln looked at the man steadily for a half minute or more, then slowly began to lift his long figure from its slouching position in the chair. He rose without haste, went over to where the man was sitting, took him by the coat collar, carried him bodily to the door, threw him in a heap outside, closed the door, and returned to his chair. He said not a word then or afterward about the incident. As for Lincoln's physical strength, during a visit to an army headquarters, he picked up a heavy axe lying beside a log. Gripping the end of its handle in his right hand, he held the axe out horizontally for some time. After he lowered it, several young soldiers tried to duplicate the feat without success. On another occasion, Lincoln removed quite a different person from his office. An important conference with high officials had run past noon, and a servant appeared, telling him that his wife expected him to join her for what may have been a more formal lunch than he usually had. Intent on the discussion, Lincoln did not even nod, and the servant left his office. Some minutes later, the same thing happened, with no sign that Lincoln noticed this second summons. Soon after that, the door of the office was flung open, and Mary Todd Lincoln walked in, the picture of imperious indignation. Still listening carefully to what was being said in the conference, the 6'4" president rose, put his exceptionally large hands on the sides of his 5'2" wife's shoulders, lifted her off the carpet, wordlessly carried her through the door, and set her down in the hall. He came back into his office, closing the door behind him, and sat down with exactly the same intent expression on his face that he had had before she entered. Shortly after the Battle of Gettysburg, this office had been the scene of two touching meetings, both witnessed by Lincoln's friend and Kentucky Unionist leader, James Speed. At the end of several hours of receiving visitors of all sorts who had been waiting in the hall, Lincoln asked Edward McManus, the White House chief doorkeeper, "Is that all?" "There's one poor woman there yet, Mr. President," Edward replied. "She's been here for several days, crying and taking on, and hasn't got a chance to come in yet." "Let her in." The woman entered and explained her situation. Her husband and two sons were in the Union Army. At first, her husband had sent home part of his pay, but then had yielded to the temptations of camp life, presumably drinking, gambling, and possibly prostitutes, and had sent her nothing for months. She did not know where her two sons were. Penniless, she was hoping that Lincoln could help her find one of them and release him to come home to help her. While the pathetic recital was going on, the President stood before the fireplace, his hands crossed behind his back, and his head bent in earnest thought. When the woman ended and waited a moment for his reply, his lips opened and he spoke, not indeed as if he were replying to what she had said, but rather as if he were in an abstracted and unconscious self-communion. "I have two, and you have none." With that, Lincoln went to his writing table and wrote out detailed instructions as to where she should go and what she should do to locate one of her sons and gain the discharge for him that he was authorizing. Several days later, again at the end of Lincoln's hours for receiving visitors, Edward said, "That woman, Mr. President, is here again, and still crying." "Let her in," Lincoln said. "What can the matter be now?" The woman came in and said that the instructions he had given her had taken her right to the unit in which one of her sons served. When she got there, she found that he had been wounded at Gettysburg and had died in a hospital. Would the President please consider discharging her remaining son? He again walked to his little writing table and took up his pen for the second time to write an order which should give the pleading woman her son. And the woman, as if moved by a filial impulse she could not restrain, moved after him and stood by him at the table as he wrote, and with the fond familiarity of a mother placed her hand upon the President's head and smoothed down his wandering and tangled hair. The order was written and signed. The President rose and thrust it into her hand with the choking ejaculation, "There!" and hurried from the room. At times, Lincoln displayed the occasionally dark side of the sense of humor that kept him going through all the stress. One night he mentioned to a friend who was in the office that he had in front of him a last-minute letter from a Catholic priest asking that he suspend an order to hang a man. "If I don't suspend it tonight," Lincoln said, "the man will surely be suspended tomorrow." He also enjoyed making up words, and characterized some people's conversational behavior as being interruptious. After Lincoln finished working at night, he often prowled restlessly through this part of the White House. He could have gone to Mary in their living quarters, but often he would find one or more of his private secretaries, John G. Nicolay, John Hay, and William Stoddard, at work in their small offices down the hall. If it was really late in the evening, he might come upon the two of them who lived in the White House, John Nicolay and John Hay, talking and perhaps having something to eat in the bedroom they shared, and would join them for some conversation. Nicolay and Hay played an immensely important part in Lincoln's daily life. The senior of them, 31-year-old John Nicolay, was born in Bavaria and came to the United States with his family at the age of 6. As had been the case with Lincoln, and this was a bond between them, Nicolay's was a story of hardship, managing to get only 2 years of education in log schoolhouses, in which, he later said, slates, pencils, paper, and ink were unknown. Living on the frontier in Lincoln's state of Illinois, he knew a life that he described as irregular and somewhat spasmodic, with quick fluctuations vibrating between plenty and want, from fullness to hunger, from dry to wet, from comfort to misery. Nothing was steady but ignorance and solitude. He became a typesetter for the small rural Pike County Free Press. In 8 years, the earnest, shy, hard-working Nicolay rose to become its editor and publisher, but still remained close to poverty. At the age of 26, then working as the principal clerk in the office of the Illinois Secretary of State in Springfield, he met Lincoln, who frequently visited those rooms in the state capitol in connection with his law practice and his political interests. Sometimes the two played chess there. When Lincoln won the Republican nomination in 1860, he hired Nicolay to handle his correspondence during the presidential campaign that took them both to the White House. As Lincoln's principal private secretary, Nicolay struck sophisticated Washingtonians as sour and crusty, and he was characterized as the bulldog in the anteroom. But no one worked harder than this loyal, driven, rail-thin man. The second of these aides was another man from Illinois, John Hay, soon to be 26, who grew up in far more comfortable circumstances and had all the charm that Nicolay lacked. Before going off to Brown University, Hay had become friends with Nicolay, who was 5 years older than he, and when Lincoln brought Nicolay with him to the White House, Hay came along. A young woman visiting Washington wrote in a letter describing her experiences in the Capitol, "The nicest-looking man I have seen since I have been here is Mr. Hay, the President's secretary. He came into the Senate the other day to deliver a message from the President. He's very nice-looking, with the loveliest voice." Another young woman was struck by his wonderful hazel eyes. Men called him brilliant and an effervescent and fascinating fellow, characterizing him as one who knew the social graces and amenities. It was not certain that Lincoln knew this, but, like Stoddard, sometimes in these midnight hours, Hay would compose anonymous letters to the editors of newspapers around the country, hoping that they would print his praise of the President's accomplishments. Nicolay occasionally did this as well. Hay's career as a public servant had just begun. In the future, he would serve as Assistant Secretary of State under President Rutherford B. Hayes, who was a Union Army general in 1864, and as Secretary of State under two presidents, William McKinley, a Union Army captain in 1864, and Theodore Roosevelt. When Lincoln chatted with these young men after all of them had finished their long working day, he often entertained them with one of the folksy little stories he loved to tell and they loved to hear. When the talk turned serious, it had far less to do with ideals than with the tactics of political survival. Lincoln was a pragmatist. Doing what he felt necessary to preserve the Union at all costs and to bring his presidency and the Union's war effort this far, he had greatly expanded the executive powers of his office. He wanted broad public and congressional support. He never forgot that he won the White House in 1860 with only 40% of the popular vote. In the wartime midterm congressional elections of 1862, his Republican Party had kept its control by the narrowest of margins only because of the Union Army's intimidation of Democratic voters in Kentucky. Armed soldiers had stood at polling places throughout the state, discouraging Democrats from voting. And without using the word Democrats, there were threats of arrest for anyone running for office on a platform hostile to the Lincoln administration. What he might not be able to accomplish through legislation in a Congress in which many opposed him, Lincoln tried to get by presidential decree. The Constitution does not include a clause on war power. Nonetheless, using that term and acting under what he believed his wartime emergency powers to be, Lincoln had, without congressional authority, blockaded the Confederacy's ports, issued calls for massive numbers of volunteers, and authorized advances of treasury funds to private citizens of the North for the purchase of armaments and ships. In addition to taking what amounted to unilateral presidential action in issuing the Emancipation Proclamation, Lincoln had at times suspended the right of habeas corpus, a citizen's most fundamental defense against illegal imprisonment. Under Lincoln's authority, military commissions were bringing to trial protesters who opposed the war, many of them individuals who had done so only with words rather than deeds. More than 14,000 citizens had been jailed and tried using these highly unusual procedures. One instance of the application of these methods was to have far-reaching consequences. When Democratic Congressman Clement Vallandigham of Ohio was convicted in May 1863 of treason for urging a crowd to topple King Lincoln from his throne, there was a great outcry, even in the middle of a war, about suppression of free speech. Lincoln decided to change the sentence of imprisonment to one of banishment from the Union, and federal troops under a flag of truce handed Vallandigham over to Confederate forces in Tennessee. The Confederate government assisted him in getting to Wilmington, North Carolina, and from that Confederate-held port, he reached neutral British soil in Bermuda aboard a swift blockade runner, the Lady Davis, named for Jefferson Davis's wife, Varina. From there, he sailed with impunity to Canada aboard a British vessel and was soon in comfortable exile. Eventually settling himself in a suite at the Hiron's House Hotel in Windsor, Ontario, across the Detroit River from Detroit, he was able to consult with any number of Democratic politicians who crossed the border to meet with him, as well as with Confederate agents who had entered Canada in a variety of ways. In an astonishing example of what was and was not permitted in the states of the wartime Union, while in exile, Vallandigham ran for governor of Ohio in absentia during the 1863 gubernatorial campaign. Even though he lost by a vote of 175,464 to 247,216 out of 422,680 ballots cast, a 60-40% defeat, the outcome nonetheless meant that close to 200,000 citizens of Ohio had voted for Lincoln's most virulent opponent. In his Canadian exile, Vallandigham stood as a symbol of potentially violent opposition to Lincoln in the states of the old Northwest, the term Midwest had not yet come into being, and was making plans to re-enter the United States illegally later in the year. Talking of these and other problems with his secretaries Nicolay and Hay brought Lincoln into interesting combinations of broad policy and specific action. Tomorrow, on the second day of 1864, he was sending Hay down to Point Lookout, Maryland, with a book of forms to be signed by Confederate prisoners of war held there who wished to take an oath of allegiance to the Union. The men who did this had two choices. They could enlist in the Union Army, as some of them wished to do, or, as Lincoln's letter of transmittal that Hay would carry said, the men whose homes lie safely within our military lines could return to their families and take no further part in the war. Here was Lincoln, waging both war and peace, girding for future battles by enlisting some former enemies in his ranks while allowing others to end their part in the fighting. These evening discussions often touched on what was the seamy side of any presidency. During Lincoln's debates with Douglas in 1858, he had characterized his opponent as being the man committed to rewarding his followers with positions involving post offices, land offices, marshalships, and cabinet appointments. But when Lincoln took office in March of 1861, the Capitol saw political patronage dispensed on an unprecedented scale. Even the Republican state chairman for New Hampshire lamented the rush to reap made by every slippery politician in the Republican Party. Lincoln participated in the process wholeheartedly. Half the communications that left his office during the first 3 weeks of May 1861, soon after his inauguration in March, involved using his influence on behalf of different individuals. Those at the top of Lincoln's incoming administration quickly feathered their nests. One of Secretary of State William H. Seward's sons was named Assistant Secretary of State. Another was appointed an Army paymaster, and a third was commissioned as a lieutenant colonel, while Seward's nephew received the post of consul in Shanghai. Of the 1,520 men who held presidential appointments under James Buchanan's outgoing Democratic administration, 1,195 lost their jobs. New postmasterships sprang into being. Any man given a job by the incoming Lincoln administration understood that he would be donating up to 10% of his salary to one of the Republican Party's treasuries. Everything was handed out, either for money or as a reward for past or prospective political support. Lincoln exceeded all previous presidents in what he did for the newspaper publishers, editors, and reporters who backed him. A simple form of this involved Lincoln's increasing the amount of required public notices and other government advertising in their papers. But he also appointed 40 journalists to positions that included governor of Utah Territory, consul general at Paris, and commissioner to the Hawaiian Islands. The great expansion of the Union Army required more leaders. It became common practice to distribute the ranks of brigadier general and colonel as political plums, often to men with no military experience. Every Union state was initially allotted a quota of 4 brigadier generals, but Lincoln stepped in and gave his state of Illinois 6. In Washington, so many of Lincoln's friends, advisors, and aides came from Illinois that the group could have been called Illinois in Washington. A need existed to rally large constituencies, such as the 500,000 military-age citizens of the North, who were German Americans, more than 200,000 of them born in Germany. Even before the war, Lincoln understood the German-speaking population's political importance. In 1860, he spent $400 to buy the Illinois Staatsanzeiger, leasing that German-language newspaper back to its editor on the understanding that it would support the Republican Party. From the war's outset, Lincoln began placing some German-Americans into the Army's command positions. Prominent among them was Major General Karl Schurz, a pre-war leader of a German political action movement, the Turners, a name derived from the German word Turner, meaning gymnast. The Turners had supported Lincoln in the 1860 election and provided his bodyguard at his inauguration. Schurz, a fiery bilingual anti-slavery orator who had campaigned enthusiastically for Lincoln, possessed minimal military experience, but when the war came, he wanted to be a general, and Lincoln made him one. As the war had progressed, hundreds of thousands of German-speaking men entered the Union Army. Many regiments from Pennsylvania, Ohio, Wisconsin, and the St. Louis area of Missouri used German as the language for giving orders. On a day in 1862, Lincoln searched for a German name to add to those of Schurz and Franz Siegel, both born in Germany, and came across that of Prussian-born Colonel Alexander Schimmelpfennig, commander of the German-speaking 74th Pennsylvania Volunteer Infantry. Lincoln said, "The very man." Secretary of War Stanton quickly told him of men with better records who were eligible to become generals. Lincoln replied, "His name will make up for any difference there may be," and walked off, happily muttering, "Schimmelpfennig." Now, with Lincoln seeking re-election 2 years later, Schurz, who along with Schimmelpfennig had proved to be a largely ineffectual general, wanted to campaign for Lincoln, and Lincoln intended to accept his help. Connections coupled with payoffs determined the awarding of millions of dollars in contracts for military supplies. Lincoln made no money from it, but proved negligent in his oversight of the corrupt actions of Simon Cameron, his first Secretary of War, who used the War Department to pay off old political debts he had incurred as a senator from Pennsylvania. Of 1,903,800 muskets and rifles Cameron ordered for the Union Army during the war's first months, 1,839,000 came from manufacturers who dealt with Cameron's cronies, and Cameron constantly steered other lucrative contracts through middlemen to manufacturers who produced shoddy goods for exorbitant sums. Among other examples, illustrative but not nearly the most egregious, the government paid $117,000 for 1,000 cavalry horses, a third of them useless, that the suppliers had acquired for less than half that price. More ways existed to gain advantages for one's political party and oneself. Even before officially declaring his wish to run again or receiving a single endorsement of any kind, Lincoln had an interesting plan in mind. He had long wanted to readmit Confederate states, as the conquest of their territory made that possible. Part of Florida had come back under federal military control, and Lincoln pushed to reconstruct a pro-Union state government there. If he could speed the process, it might result in Florida sending a pro-Lincoln delegation to the Republican convention later in the year. 6. At about 11 p.m., Lincoln would stop working in his office. Sometimes his son Tad, 10 years old as 1864 began, would be asleep in an armchair, having dozed off much earlier, when they went through their ritual of Tad telling him everything he had done during the day. On nights when Tad was still there in the shop, a friend of Lincoln's said, "Shouldering the sleeping child, the man for whom millions of good men and women nightly prayed took his way through the silent corridors and passages to his boy's bedroom." In the family quarters, Mary would be waiting up for him. As at supper, they would chat in friendly fashion, Lincoln often fondly calling her mother. But Mary resented having so little of his time in the evenings. Jealous of any woman who paid attention to her husband, she also saw the war as her rival. That was only partly true. When Abraham Lincoln finally went to go to bed in his room next to Mary's on the first night of 1864, the many crises facing the nation weighed on him, but part of him cared very much for Mary and had continuing concerns about her. He saw her inconsistencies. She wanted the prominence that came with her position, yet she made no effort to attract notice of her frequent visits to the wounded soldiers in Washington's hospitals. He worried about Mary's mental health. For months after Willie's death, the mention of his name provoked hysterical sobbing, and Lincoln employed a nurse to care for her. In her efforts to come to terms with her loss, Mary began attending seances conducted by spiritualists, then quite popular in Washington society. In a dimly lit room of the house of a spiritualist couple named Laurie, who lived in the suburb of Georgetown, she came under the influence of clairvoyance, who convinced Mary that during their sessions, she was in communication with her sons Willie and Eddie. At times when these mediums seemed unable to conjure up Willie's spirit, they gave Mary what purported to be advance news of Confederate military movements, which she swiftly relayed to her husband. Mary also arranged to have 8 seances conducted in the White House. Lincoln attended at least one of these in an effort to protect Mary and to study the individuals manipulating her. During the nearly 2 years after Willie's death, Mary seemed to emerge from her grief to some extent, but her half-sister, Emily Todd Helm, had an extraordinary experience with her during her visit to the Lincolns less than a month before this New Year's of 1864. Mary entered her room at the White House one night, her eyes wide and shining. Emily wrote in her diary what came next. Speaking of Willie, Mary said, "He lives, Emily. He comes to me every night and stands at the foot of my bed with the same sweet, adorable smile he always has had. He does not always come alone. Little Eddie is sometimes with him. You cannot dream of the comfort this gives me. When I thought of my little son in immensity, alone, without his mother to direct him, It nearly broke my heart. Emily added that Mary was so nervous and wrought up and is on a terrible strain. As for the whole episode, she wrote, it is unnatural and abnormal. It frightens me. Lincoln had learned to be careful about what he confided to Mary. As far back as 1847, when she accompanied him to Washington to start the one term he served in Congress, David Davis, an Illinois lawyer and circuit judge who later managed Lincoln's 1860 presidential campaign, remarked, she wishes to loom largely. The first presidential wife to be called the First Lady, a title bestowed on her by William Howard Russell, the Washington correspondent of the Times of London, when Lincoln began his presidency in 1861, Mary acted as if she were a conduit of power herself, writing to newspaper editors and chatting with senators about her opinions on matters of state. She earned the enmity of Secretary of State Seward by referring to him as that abolition sneak, and also alienated Secretary of War Stanton. Both men remained on excellent terms with Lincoln. Even worse for a woman married to a man known as Honest Abe, her handling of money revealed serious character defects. She had a horror of becoming poor, something she had never been nor was likely to be, and at the same time spent money compulsively, once buying 400 pairs of gloves in 3 months. Congress voted Lincoln, whose salary was $25,000, the customary appropriation of $20,000 given to incoming presidents to redecorate the White House. When he turned that over to Mary, she swiftly ran up bills for china, crystal, silver, rugs, curtains, and repainting that came to $6,700 more than that. Lincoln found such expenditures in the middle of a war shocking, but Mary had just started, moving from spending money for public purposes to private gain. On a trip to New York, she ordered for the White House a set of china that bore the seal of the United States, and then ordered another set to be decorated with her initials, charging both to the government. Mary's favorite place to shop in New York was A.T. Stewart's elegant department store, built of marble and covering a square block. Henry James later described the place as being fatal to feminine nerves. On one of her 11 wartime visits to this emporium, she bought with her own money several black lace point shawls for $650 each, and the real camel's hair cashmere at $1,000. Mary soon realized she would have to develop other sources of income to support her habits, and find ways to avoid her husband's learning of these spending sprees. In collusion with John Watt, superintendent of the White House grounds, she began to present the Treasury with receipts for the purchase of every kind of seed, fruit tree, and bush, most of which were never ordered or planted. At a time when a Union Army private made $13 a month, they shared the governmental reimbursements for more than $1,000 of these non-existent purchases. And Mary showed a certain ingenuity in her additional fraudulent itemization. She billed the government for $700.75 for flowers that never grew, and $107.50 for manure that never fertilized anything, and added a charge for a horse and cart that never carried the phantom manure. Mary and Watt expanded this practice to include the misrepresentation of the amount of food bought for the White House. Slowly, rumors about the First Lady's financial maneuvers began to spread through various circles in Washington. One of the people who had a definite opinion about Mary was David Davis, the judge from Illinois whose masterful job of running Lincoln's 1860 presidential campaign had been rewarded when Lincoln named him to the Supreme Court. When former Senator Orville Browning of Illinois, another of Lincoln's old friends from his pre-war political career, Illinois and Washington, defended Mary's reputation in a conversation with him, Justice Davis replied that she was a natural-born thief, stealing was a sort of insanity with her. Mary's record in financial matters would get worse, and better known, as her time in the White House went on. Her alleged behavior with men also caused gossip. On her shopping trips to New York in the first half of 1861 to refurbish the White House, she was accompanied by William S. Wood, whom Mary had asked a number of Lincoln's friends to support for the position of Commissioner of Public Buildings, to which Lincoln then appointed him. An anonymous letter to Lincoln, dated June 28, 1861, signed Union, spoke of the scandal of your wife and Wood. If he continues as commissioner, he will stab you in your most vital part. Lincoln King of Iowa, no relation of the president's, later said that Mary used often to go from the White House to New York to pass the night with a man who held a high government office in Washington, given to him by her husband. Richard Yates, then governor of Illinois, indicated that Mary was not true to her husband, while John Watt, the man with whom she conspired on fraudulent payments for White House expenses, claimed after falling out with her that Mrs. Lincoln's relations with certain men were indecently improper. Mary believed in her husband and wanted him to be nominated and win the coming campaign. But she also saw this election as a way to get out of debt and avoid Lincoln's learning more details of her compulsive extravagance. These included gifts to herself, such as diamond earrings and gold-plated clocks. Her seamstress, Elizabeth Keckley, alleged that Mary eventually owed store bills amounting to $70,000, but the figure came closer to $10,000. She planned to use everything at her disposal, ranging from choice White House invitations for favored supporters to none too subtle suggestions that she could secure important government appointments if Lincoln won a second term. Mary intended to link her implied influence with requests for gifts to her of money, with which she would satisfy the merchants, the jewelers and clockmakers, the milliners and seamstresses who still expected to be paid. By 1864, this was an old game for Mary. There could be no doubt that she was already engaged in quid pro quo influence peddling, even at the time when Lincoln had been elected for his first term and before they left Springfield for his inauguration. A shady character named Isaac Henderson, publisher of the New York Evening Post, had sent the soon-to-be First Lady some diamonds, and she knew that he wanted the lucrative position of naval agent in the New York Customs House. On the eve of the Lincoln's departure for Washington, a friend of Lincoln's named Herman Kreisman came to the hotel where they were staying to ask why he was late for a meeting. He found Mary in hysterics. Lincoln explained, "Kreisman, she will not let me go until I promise her an office for one of her friends." Mary's friend was Henderson. In April, Lincoln appointed him to the Customs House position, from which he was later dismissed on unproven charges that he had taken kickbacks from contractors doing business with the Brooklyn Navy Yard. Lincoln seldom spoke of his feelings for Mary, but once, turning to a friend in the midst of a White House reception, he said impulsively, using the word handsome as the synonym for beautiful it then was, "My wife is as handsome as when she was a girl, and I, a poor nobody then, fell in love with her, and have never fallen out." On the other hand, he occasionally revealed a negative view of marriage, presumably based on his own experience. Pardoning an imprisoned soldier who had deserted and wanted to go home to marry, he commented that, "Probably in less than a year, the young man would wish that he had stayed in his prison cell." 7. As the first day of 1864 ticked away, it seemed that the outcome of every major issue in the country depended on the man whom Mary called Mr. Lincoln. In his Gettysburg Address, he had laid out the great task remaining before us: that this nation shall have a new birth of freedom, and that this government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. Lincoln spoke then of the last full measure of devotion given by the Union soldiers who died at Gettysburg. The coming year would test the limits of Lincoln's physical and mental strength, his political and military instincts, his idealism and character. 33 months into this ghastly war, Lincoln faced not only the obvious problems of his presidency, but also a question of personal integrity, clothed in what looked like an important but objective decision. He had been doing a lot of thinking about Major General Ulysses S. Grant, who had resigned from the pre-war regular army as a captain in 1854, rather than face a court-martial for being drunk while on duty. Grant had begun this war by re-entering the army as a colonel of volunteers. Far fewer officers held the prestigious regular commissions, and even West Pointers like Grant, who had resigned as regulars, received volunteer commissions as they re-entered the army. First, leading an infantry regiment of fewer than 1,000 soldiers, Grant's meteoric rise in the Western theater led to his becoming a major general of volunteers. By the time of his great triumph at Vicksburg on July 4, 1863, he commanded 71,000 men. 5 weeks before this New Year's Day, he had rescued the Union cause from disaster after the Confederate blow at Chickamauga by winning a critical victory at Chattanooga. After Vicksburg, Lincoln had made Grant a major general in the regular army and sent him a profoundly grateful letter of congratulations. Earlier, he had said that if Grant could win at Vicksburg, "Grant is my man, and I am his for the rest of the war." But as 1864 began, Lincoln had not moved Grant above his position as commander of the Western Theater. Although George Gordon Meade had won the great victory at Gettysburg, Grant's overall record, Fort Donelson, Shiloh, Vicksburg, Chattanooga, clearly established him as the man who should become general-in-chief of the entire Union Army. The idea of this further promotion for Grant brought Lincoln into conflict between his responsibilities as the commander-in-chief and his ambition to be re-elected as president. At this point, Grant's name resounded through the North as an eminently successful general. He had no clear party affiliation, and many in both the Republican and Democratic parties thought he could win the presidency if he ran in the coming election. By promoting Grant to lieutenant general, superseding the less able current general-in-chief, Major General Henry W. Halleck, in a move that would make Grant the Union's supreme military commander, Lincoln might shorten the war. That would save both Northern and Southern lives, but to promote Grant would also give a potential political rival even more credibility and fame. Lincoln approached this conundrum by using an intermediary. He asked Republican Congressman Elihu Washburn, who represented Grant's home district in Illinois and had used his influence on Grant's behalf throughout the war, Illinois and Washington, to ascertain whether Grant had his eye on the presidency. Washburn responded that Grant's friend, J. Russell Jones of Chicago, might know. As the new year began, Lincoln hoped to hear from Jones. Inescapably, this man in the White House at midnight of the first day of 1864 had everything bearing down on him, the war itself, the rapidly eroding public support for the war, the passionate political opposition he and his administration inspired, continuing grief for his beloved son Willie, the anguish of his erratic wife Mary at their loss. In addition to his other duties and responsibilities, he faced the struggle to win a second term. What Lincoln had said 2 years before, telling the people of the nation they could not dodge the decisions and sacrifices confronting them, "Fellow citizens, we cannot escape history," now applied to him with unique and enormous force. If in the coming year he lost his bid for re-election, if the objectives for which the Union entered the war were bargained away, if Robert E. Lee and his remarkable soldiers could bring off some victory that fatally weakened the faltering Northern support for the war, Lincoln's place in history would be that of a huge failure in a vast, pointless tragedy. The coming months would require a special personal philosophy. He had that, drawn from his days floating 30-foot-long flatboats filled with cargo down the Mississippi River to New Orleans. Earlier, he had explained to Republican Congressman James G. Blaine of Maine how he saw some of what lay ahead. "The pilots on our western rivers steer from point to point, as they call it, setting the course of the boat no farther than they can see. And that is all I propose to myself in this great problem." That was Lincoln the tactician, the Lincoln who understood that in politics you took as much as you could get and seldom got everything you wanted. But in the White House, the citizens also had Lincoln the strategist, not only the leader determined to preserve the Union by fighting the war, but the man of the West who saw beyond the next bend in the river. Here, the people had the visionary who sprang from the poorest among them, the awkward and eloquent frontiersman who could picture so much and then make it real, even in the midst of war and political crisis. As 1864 began, few understood how much else he was making happen, far from the battlefields, because of his policies, the legislation he initiated, the federal subsidies for the programs he supported and encouraged. Railroads were starting to cross the continent, with telegraph lines running beside them. Hundreds of thousands of immigrants were arriving to begin farming land given them by the government. Unaffiliated banks were being consolidated into a stronger national system. The Union experienced growth in mines, in harvested timber, in the number of factories, and the workers who labored in them. There would always be mystery about Lincoln, the elusive questions attendant upon greatness, but this shambling, rumpled figure with the sad face and the sudden, sweet smile was a man for all seasons, arriving in the nation's winter, its darkest hour, believing that God would yet grant America a rich harvest. And so Abraham Lincoln, and the people of the Union, and the free and enslaved people of the Confederacy, headed into 1864. Chapter 2. Steering into a Stormy Year. On January 11, Lincoln began his part in the year's maneuvering for his re-election by meeting quietly with Francis Preston Blair, the head of a powerful Republican political family. At the war's outset, Blair had been Lincoln's intermediary in offering Robert E. Lee the command of the Union Army. His younger son, Francis Jr., who started the war as a congressman and went on to become a major general, had been instrumental in keeping both Missouri and Kentucky from joining the Confederacy. His older son, Montgomery, Lincoln's postmaster general, once summed up the Klan's determination with, "When the Blairs go in for a fight, they go in for a funeral." The topic on this January morning was not how to beat the Democrats in November, but how to deal with Lincoln's Secretary of the Treasury, Salmon Portland Chase, a former United States Senator from Ohio and later that state's governor. Chase was managing the Union's finances superbly in a time of crisis, but wanted to become president himself. To some degree, the political fates of Chase, Lincoln, and Secretary of State Seward were intertwined. During the 1860 election, both Chase and Seward, the latter a past senator from New York State as well as its former governor, had seen themselves as far better qualified to become president than Lincoln was. At that point, Lincoln's office-holding experience consisted of 8 consecutive years in the Illinois legislature and 1 2-year term in Congress. What national reputation he had came only through his debates with Stephen Douglas in 1858 and an impressive speech he made in 1860 at New York's Cooper Institute, sometimes called Cooper Union. James Russell Lowell of the Harvard faculty, who wrote acute wartime political articles, said that Lincoln slipped into the White House by default, a compromise candidate who was acceptable to a barely sufficient number of politicians and voters because he had no history. When Lincoln won, he appointed both men to his cabinet. Seward, who had started 1860 as the Republican frontrunner, initially tried to expand his role into something of a co-president. At one point, when Seward said that it was he who should hold the first official reception of the newly elected Lincoln administration, Mary Lincoln shot back, "It is said that you are the power behind the throne. I'll show you that Mr. Lincoln is president yet." In December of 1862, 9 radical Republican senators tried to persuade Lincoln to remove Seward from his cabinet, basing their effort on the grounds that he and not Lincoln dominated Union policy, and that Seward displayed lukewarmness in the conduct of the war and gave Lincoln poor advice on military matters. The attempt produced offers to resign, not only from Seward, but also, to make it easier for Lincoln to remove them as well if he wished to, from Chase, himself a radical, and Secretary of War Stanton. Lincoln refused all 3 offers, the essence of the situation being his determination to stop the legislature's capture of the chief executive's right to appoint and remove the members of his cabinet. He saw himself as the real target of the radical senator's move. "They wish to get rid of me," he told his friend Orville Browning. Seward and Stanton had gone on to become the key figures in Lincoln's cabinet. At the outset of the war, Seward had in fact made some errors in judgment. He thought the struggle might blow over, and also initially took such a hard line against England's guarded sympathy for the South that Lincoln had to lessen the force of words Seward intended to use. Thereafter, Seward conducted an effective, far-seeing foreign policy, and emerged as a friend to whom Lincoln turned for companionship and advice in many situations. Seward could move swiftly on domestic as well as foreign matters. At the end of September 1863, Lincoln sent over to Seward a letter he had just received from Sarah Josepha Hale, the editor of Lady's Book, the most influential American women's magazine. She asked the president to reinstate an annual proclamation of a day of thanksgiving, an announcement that had been allowed to lapse since 1818, and to appoint the last Thursday of November annually as Thanksgiving Day. Despite the daily demands on both Seward and Lincoln, on October 3, Lincoln issued the eloquently worded Proclamation of Thanksgiving, written by Seward, that set the precedent for observing the last Thursday of November as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. Chase presented a different picture. He performed exceedingly well in his treasury post, but remained convinced that the nomination of Lincoln at the 1860 Republican Convention in Chicago had been some sort of error, a bad dream from which the nation would awaken by electing him in 1864. He had no doubt that he could do a better job of leading the Union. "There is no administration, properly speaking," he wrote, complaining of the lack of agendas and systematic reporting at Lincoln's often sparsely attended cabinet meetings. When it came to the cabinet's role in trying to save the country, he said, "We have as little to do with it as if we were heads of factories supplying shoes or clothing." According to Browning, it was Chase, supposedly Seward's cabinet ally, although a radical himself, who had told radical senators that Seward exercised a backstairs and malign influence upon the president and thwarted all measures of the cabinet. Chase resented what he considered to be Seward's poaching in the appointment of New York and Boston Customs House positions that he felt were his to fill, and also lost out to Seward in other appointments, such as postmasterships that fell in neither of their political spheres. Other members of Lincoln's cabinet saw Chase as being fully engaged in every kind of political infighting. On October 17, 1863, Attorney General Edward Bates wrote in his diary, "I'm afraid Mr. Chase's head is turned by his eagerness in pursuit of the presidency." For a long time back he has been filling all the offices in his own vast patronage with extreme partisans, and contrives also to fill many vacancies properly belonging to other departments. As 1864 began, Chase disavowed any interest in becoming the Republican candidate, but this convinced no one. Colonel J. H. Poulston of the state of Pennsylvania's purchasing agency in Washington said of a recent conversation with Chase that he had presidency glaring out of both eyes. Lincoln saw it, commenting to his secretary John Hay that no man knows what that gnawing is till he has had it. 10,000 Treasury Department employees around the nation felt unmistakable pressure from the top to work on Chase's behalf and to contribute money to his campaign when the time came. In addition to Chase's national prominence, commanding presence, and many political connections, he had another asset in the person of his daughter, Kate Chase Sprague. Because Chase was a widower, she acted as his hostess in his Washington mansion. Beautiful, tall and slender, with creamy skin, thick chestnut hair, and a low musical voice, the charming and witty Kate was equally adept at chatting about Washington gossip or speaking knowledgeably about important legislative issues. She complimented women on their gowns and had a nearly hypnotic effect on men. The newspapers loved her. Kate's wedding 2 months before to William Sprague, the wealthy young senator from Rhode Island, was the Capitol's most talked-of social event of the past decade. Lincoln's secretary, John Hay, stubbornly loyal to the president, said, "Miss Chase is so busy making her father president that she is only a little lovelier than all other women." But, he admitted, "she is a great woman and with a great future." Predictably, Kate was the incarnation of all that Mary Todd Lincoln disliked about Washington. Mary was better educated than most of the socialites, who she knew regarded her as an overdressed little provincial nobody. The story about Mary's first meeting with Kate at the beginning of Lincoln's presidency may not have been true, but it was widely believed. When Mary said to her, "I shall be glad to see you any time, Miss Chase," she responded with, "Mrs. Lincoln, I shall be glad to have you call on me at any time." When Lincoln made the fatal husbandly mistake of describing Kate as young and handsome, Mary exploded with, "Young and handsome, you call her? You should not judge beauty for me." The social rivalry between them was underscored when Mary stayed away from Kate's wedding, held at the Chase Mansion, and the president went by himself. In his confidential discussion with Lincoln, Blair suggested that the president should ask Chase to resign, something that Chase had offered to do in December of 1862 and again in May of 1863. But Lincoln decided to leave his Treasury Secretary in political limbo. To win the Republican nomination, Chase needed to become sufficiently attractive to Republicans of all persuasions, and he might find it hard to rally support for himself as the nation's future leader while still professing to be a loyal member of Lincoln's cabinet. 2. The night following Lincoln's talk with Blair, the members of the Democratic National Committee gathered in New York City at the Fifth Avenue mansion of their chairman, the financier August Belmont. Joined by the editors of several newspapers that supported the party, they agreed with the strategy their host put before them. The best man to name as the Democratic presidential candidate would be Major General George Brinton McClellan. Just as Lincoln would have to cope with the division in his party between the radicals and moderates like himself, Belmont had to deal with the fissures in the Democratic Party. He believed that McClellan would be embraced by the War Democrats, and that the Peace Democrat Copperhead wing of the party would have to come along with the majority. George McClellan embodied the original Greek meaning of the word tragedy, what might have been. Brilliant at West Point, He was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Army's elite corps of engineers and posted an excellent record in the Mexican War. Although marked as one of the Army's future generals, he became impatient with slow peacetime promotions and resigned to enter business. On the eve of the Civil War, he was the highly paid president of the Eastern Division of the Ohio and Mississippi Railroad. With the country at war, he was back in the Army, first as a major general of volunteers, and soon after that as a major general with a regular Army commission. When Lincoln made him general-in-chief of the entire Union Army, Little Mac succeeded admirably in organizing and training its vast forces, but subsequently failed as a field commander. Despite having superiority in numbers and materiel, McClellan simply would not attack the Confederates. From the outset, McClellan thought himself a better man than Lincoln. He told his wife that Lincoln was an idiot and began referring to him as the original gorilla and nothing more than a well-meaning baboon. When, after many months, he realized that the patient Lincoln might relieve him for having squandered every military opportunity, he wrote his wife, "I can never regard him with other feelings than those of thorough contempt for his mind, heart, and morality." His self-serving vision was that Lincoln and others in Washington had conspired to weaken his immense Army of the Potomac so as to render it inadequate to accomplish the end in view, and then to hold me responsible for the results. When McClellan did not attack Robert E. Lee during the Confederate retreat after the Battle of Antietam in September of 1862, the exasperated president said of him, "He is an admirable engineer, but he seems to have a special talent for a stationary engine." Even then, Lincoln exercised more patience, but McClellan finally pushed him too far. In late October, 6 weeks after Antietam, he told Lincoln that he still could not go after Lee because his army's horses were absolutely broken down from fatigue. Lincoln acidly inquired, "Will you pardon me for asking what the horses of your army have done since the Battle of Antietam that fatigue anything?" Within a week, he relieved McClellan of all military commands. McClellan returned to his house in New Jersey, waiting for further orders that never came. The extent of McClellan's failings never became known to the public. Little Mac, short and dapper, had been popular with his soldiers. The picture of self-assurance, he spoke well. All in all, the Democratic leaders meeting at Belmont's house felt they had the right man. It would be hard to accuse a Union Army general of being a peace Democrat. 3. By mid-January, the political maneuvering had intensified. Lincoln remained wary of Chase's thus far undeclared candidacy and knew that other Republican contenders might enter the picture. He began to put out the word through Republican circles in every northern state that he did in fact seek re-election and would welcome endorsements as soon as possible. Lincoln did not have to wait long. On January 23, the New York State Republican Committee endorsed him. The record of the correspondence he dealt with in his shop on this same day reveals the range of other matters with which the president had to cope. The most important of these was a long letter Lincoln wrote in his own hand, replying to an inquiry as to how the government would regard cases in which the southern owners of cotton plantations in areas back under federal control would free their slaves and pay them wages to continue doing the work they had been doing before. Lincoln replied, "I should regard such cases with great favor, and treat them, the former slaves, precisely as I would the same number of white people in the same relation and condition." He followed this by writing a permit for 3 Kentuckians, one a cousin of the late Henry Clay, to free their slaves and start paying them on plantations they owned in Mississippi and Arkansas. In a leap to another area of his responsibilities, Lincoln then signed a modification to the 1858 treaty between the United States and China prepared for his signature by Secretary of State Seward. The next thing he wrote, after reviewing the record of good behavior of a prisoner in the District of Columbia jail, was a note to Attorney General Edward Bates that said in its entirety, "Honorable Attorney General, please make out and send me a pardon in this case. A. Lincoln." This was Lincoln at work, hour after hour. One of his secretaries was always at hand, ready to write whatever he dictated or directed to be written for his signature. But often, after receiving one of his endless streams of visitors, Lincoln simply jotted down his disposition of the matter, sometimes before the person who had come to him was out the door of his big office. He would then place it on the day's growing stack of communications to be mailed or carried by messenger to other government offices in Washington. Interestingly, an examination of the original letters shows that this master of the language frequently wrote its, it apostrophe s, where its, its would have been grammatically correct, and that he never capitalized the first letter of the day of the week. As for punctuation, Lincoln told a friend, "I have a great respect for the semicolon. It's a very useful little chap." There were those who thought Lincoln's involvement with details wasted his time, but it served two purposes. He cut through red tape, a term already in use, referring to the ribbons used to tie up stacks of documents. A memo from the president received swift attention. Occasionally, he combined a valid interest with a touch of whimsy. Writing a memo to the ferociously hard-working Stanton, a man not noted for his sense of humor, he gave this instruction to his Secretary of War. "Please have the Adjutant General ascertain whether Second Lieutenant of Company D, 2nd Infantry, Alexander E. Drake, is entitled to promotion. His wife thinks he is. Please have this looked into." Apart from getting action on specific matters, all this fit into his public opinion baths, speaking with many ordinary citizens, as well as answering letters from all over the country. The people he met or corresponded with kept spreading the word that a real person lived in the White House, a man who listened and cared. He sometimes received 50 visitors a day. Few had an appointment. Those who chose to walk into the White House on their own waited in the hall outside Lincoln's office until their turns came. This occasionally spilled over into hours scheduled for other matters. One day, Navy Secretary Gideon Welles noted this in his diary. "As I went into the cabinet meeting, a fair, plump lady pressed forward and insisted she must see the president only for a moment, wanted nothing." Welles asked her a few questions and then went in and told Lincoln that this lady from Dubuque, Iowa was visiting in the East and said that she came from Baltimore expressly to have a look at President Lincoln. Lincoln delayed the meeting and had her shown in. When he saw her, he laughed and said, "Well, in the matter of looking at each other, I have altogether the advantage." The lady left happily a few moments later, clutching a piece of paper with his autograph. Lincoln was a compassionate man, but there was an additional aspect to his willingness to oblige those who waited to see him in his office. During his four successive two-year terms in the Illinois House of Representatives, he had learned about constituent service. If you helped individual voters who came to you with their problems, they were likely to vote for you the next time you ran for office. And if you were president, no matter what state the visitor in your office came from, he or she could probably help get you a few votes in a national election. That was pragmatism. But at other moments, Lincoln showed how much he cherished life, even in the midst of a war. On a warm but windy Tuesday morning, when Lincoln's office windows were open, his friend Colonel John Eaton was with him when gunfire sounded from the northwest, soon followed by the smell of gunpowder. Lincoln turned from the window, tears running down his cheeks. It was the day of the week when deserters were shot by firing squads at the execution grounds some distance up 14th Street. Lincoln suspended fully half the death sentences brought to his attention, sending them back for further review, making a recommendation for clemency, or sometimes issuing a pardon, but remained mindful of his general's belief that those who deserted in the face of the enemy had to be severely punished to preserve discipline in the army as a whole. He had heard the Tuesday gunfire often, but could never get used to it. 4. Mary Lincoln did not intend to wait for the political conventions scheduled for later in the year. She began accelerating her own campaign to get her husband reelected, and in the process raised some funds to pay off her debts. She started inviting prominent men, who seldom brought their wives, to what was, in effect, a political salon over which she presided in the Blue Room of the White House. Of these evening gatherings, she told her black seamstress Elizabeth Keckley, "These men have influence, and we require influence to re-elect Mr. Lincoln." She went on to say of her husband, "He glances at my rich dresses and is happy to believe that the few $100 that I obtain from him supply all my wants. If he's re-elected, I can keep him in ignorance of my affairs, but if he is defeated, then the bills will be sent in, and he will know all." Among her guests was a man named Abram Wakeman, who was the postmaster of New York City, and coveted the customs house job of surveyor of the Port of New York, the administration's second best patronage position after collector of the port. He had played an important part in getting New York's Central Republican Committee to give Lincoln the welcome endorsement he received late in January. Wakeman was also renegotiating Mary's bills with merchants in Manhattan. A letter from her told him, "Please say not a word to anyone about the Fifth Avenue business." Wakeman would be appointed to the post he wanted, surveyor of the Port of New York. Mary did not confine her efforts to the White House and visited officials in their offices and homes. "That lady," Commissioner of Agriculture Isaac Newton soon told John Hay, "has set here on this sofy and shed tears by the pint, a-begging me to pay her debts, which was unbeknownst to the President." She began to get the idea that if Lincoln were defeated, it would be her fault, in good part because opposition politicians might get hold of the particulars of her debts and use them against her husband. This thought, Elizabeth Keckley said, made Mary almost crazy with anxiety and fear. As January ended, pressures on Lincoln existed that most citizens did not even connect with the White House. In the midst of war, settlers continued to push west. In some places, the Indians were fighting those taking their lands. They also had well-founded grievances about the breaking of treaties with their tribes and about the corruption among Indian office supervisors who, among other things, sold off entire warehouses filled with badly needed food the tribes had been promised. In 1862 and 1863, there were uprisings in Wisconsin, Minnesota, and the Dakota and Nebraska territories, attacks so bloody that Union Army units were sent back from fighting the Confederates to quell them. Now, in the last week of January, a diplomatically delicate situation arose. Federal cavalry wanted to chase some bands of rebellious Sioux warriors into the Red River Country and Hudson's Bay territories of Canada, as well as to stop others from using Canada as a safe haven from which to make further raids on American frontier settlements. This would involve armed American incursions across the Canadian border, and Lincoln had authorized Secretary of State Seward to ask what the President called the authorities of Great Britain for permission to do that. Canada's ties to England were strong, and British troops served there. The most important goal of the Union's foreign policy was to keep England neutral. This had not been easy to do. in part because the United States Navy's blockade of Confederate-held ports caused a critical shortage of Southern cotton for hundreds of British textile mills that had always depended on that supply. Within England, there were sporadic mercantile efforts to bring England into an alliance with the Confederacy. Early in the war, when a United States Navy warship stopped the British mail steamer Trent on the high seas and removed two Confederate envoys heading for England, hostilities might have occurred. In one of the first of many tests of his diplomatic skill, Secretary of State Seward managed to avert a situation in which the Union's fleet might have found itself fighting the far stronger Royal Navy. This potential crisis with England in late January evaporated, with no record of a pursuit into Canada. But Lincoln's priorities placed the development of the Western Territories, the discovery of mineral wealth, and the building of railroads that gave the economy needed stimulation in the middle of a war, ahead of any rights or needs of the Indian tribes. In his annual message to Congress given the past December, he said, "Sound policy and our imperative..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.